Do the days go by so fast? Only the time we built to last.
What's up, vinyl community? What's up, music lovers? I can't help but geek out just a little bit. What a great day, right? First of all, I'm wearing my new hat that my friend Daniel gave me the other day. Made in Mexico, handmade. Thank you, Daniel. Love you for that. By the way, Daniel has a YouTube video, or a YouTube channel, rather, called Soundtracks with Birdman. So if you get a chance, check that out. I'm also in a really good mood because we're going to talk about Los Lobos. I started a video channel so that I could show some love and shine a light on some artists and some bands and some records that I just don't feel like, for whatever reason, get a whole lot of love in the vinyl community. I don't really get that, and Los Lobos certainly falls into that category. I can't find a ranking video. I can't find, I mean, there's a couple of older documentaries. We'll talk about those in a moment. But by and large, a Latin Playboys record gets mentioned here and there, or Kiko gets mentioned here and there, but that's pretty much about it. I would ask you, you know, ask your, if you know Los Lobos, or even if you don't, ask the next four or five people that you hang out with, hey, what do you know about Los Lobos? For the most part, what they're going to say or ask is, hey, isn't that La Bamba band? Yeah, they are. But they're so much more than that La Bamba band. Los Lobos has 17 full-length studio albums. They've got 7 live albums. They've got 3 EPs. They've got 3 comps, one of which is a 4-disc box set, and they have played on dozens of soundtracks and compilations and guest appearances on other folks' records. So they've been nominated for Grammy 11 different times. 4 times they've taken those home. And so, you know, I said criminally underrated bands, not critically, because the critics loved these guys. So with all of the critical acclaim and with the body of work, with the Grammy Awards and this and that and the other thing, why isn't it that most people don't know more about Los Lobos? And I have a theory about that. I think that a lot of people just really, and it doesn't matter if you're the record buying public or if you're a program director or if you're a DJ or if you're a playlist maker or a music informer, it doesn't really matter. You know, the whole thing is, lost my train of thought and I can't start over. I don't want to start over. The bottom line is, y'all, I don't think that most people know what to do with Los Lobos. Are they a Mexican band that plays American music? Are they an American band that plays Mexican music? Well, the answer is yeah. Yeah, they are. You know, of the 5 original members of Los Lobos, only one of them were born in Mexico, and that would be Cesar Rosas. The rest of them were born in East Los Angeles in the barrio, in the neighborhood, and Cesar moved there with his family when he was about 8 or 9 years old. So these guys knew of each other, and by the time high school rolled around, some friendships started to form. Now, here's the deal. We have, as you saw from the intro, a lot of material to look at. We're not going to look at every single record and every single CD, but in allowing ourselves a little bit of time to look at these records, I want to kind of keep their history short and sweet. If you want to know more about it, you can check out Chris Morris's excellent book, Dreamin' Blue, which tells the full story. But these guys grew up in East LA. They were first or second generation Mexican Americans, and they were basically rock and roll kids. I mean, English was the language that was spoken primarily in all of their households. And by the time they began to form friendships, they were already, like a lot of American kids at that time, were in different bands. Funk band and an R&B soul band and a rock and roll covers band and that type of thing. Dave Hidalgo and Louis Perez met each other in art class at Garfield High School and realized that in addition to an affinity for Cream and Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin, that they also loved things like Fairport Convention and Randy Newman and Ry Cooder. Those are not 3 names that most high school kids, even back then, are going to be trading back and forth. And so they realized pretty quickly, and right there, you know, if you form a high school friendship over a love of bands that no one else really in your circle seems to get, that's usually a bond that lasts quite a while. And with Louis and Dave, it's lasted a lifetime. You also had Cesar Rosas, who was leaned more towards the R&B and blues side of things. and had a little band, and was hanging out in his garage one day with the door open, and he saw this chubby Mexican kid walk by playing an old school mandolin, singing an old school Mexican folk song. And he called him over, "What are you doing?" They started hanging out, realized that they both really had kind of an affinity, not just for the rock and roll of the day, but for their cultural root music, that norteño, the cumbias, the mariachi, all of that. And, you know, started to play those things and hone those things down. And before long, Cesar said, "Hey, I've got this buddy, David Hidalgo. He plays guitar and can sing, and he's really good." And they brought Dave in, and before long, Dave said, "Hey, I've got this buddy, Louis Perez. He can play guitar and drums, and he sings some too." And they brought him in. And so now, you know, they've got a band. They have a bass player at first, but he turns out to be a little bit flaky, not making it for rehearsals and shows and stuff like that. So they enlisted the help of local bass guitar hero, Conrad Lozano. He of the huge smile and the wonderful solid in the pocket bass playing. They brought him on board, and now they're a quintet. You've got Frank Gonzalez, you've got Cesar Rosas, you've got David Hidalgo, you've got Louis Perez, and you've got Conrad Lozano. And, you know, their love for that old school music was a little bit different than what everybody else was interested in at the time. And, you know, if you watch videos, and there are quite a few of them, Louis Perez will say that, "Hey, we just wanted to learn a couple of Mexican folk songs to make our moms happy," right? They certainly weren't ashamed of their culture, and they weren't ashamed of their parents' music. All of that stuff that they had absorbed as they were kids. So they're learning this music, they're getting better, they're getting their chops down. One thing that really helped them and was in their favor at the time is that, you know, in the early to mid 70s, kids were buying Stratocasters and Gibsons and drum kits and that type of thing. They weren't buying guitarrons and bajo sextos and mandolins and things like that. So these guys could cruise into a pawn shop in East LA and pick up some of these instruments for like 15, 20 bucks a piece. And so before long, I mean, they've got like 15 different instruments in the band. You've got Frank on mandolin, guitar, and the Veracruz harp. You've got David Hidalgo, wonderful guitar player, soulful vocalist, although he's not really singing yet, can play pretty much any stringed instrument that you put into his hands. You've got Louis Perez playing multiple stringed instruments, but also playing drums. You've got Conrad playing the bass, and that whether it's upright or electric or the huge guitarron. And then you've got Cesar holding it down with his R&B grooves and that type of thing, always to the left of the band because he played left-handed, and that way his guitar wasn't poking anybody in the eye or anything like that. But so they start to really hone in this sound, and they're about the only people around that are doing that. Before long, they start playing weddings and quinceañeras and different types of local events. And at that time also, colleges, there was a huge Latino and Mexican cultural awakening going on the West Coast, and colleges were getting nice funding to put on shows featuring this music and featuring art and different things that were related to that culture. So these guys, man, just went from having fun to all of a sudden now they've got a paying gig. I mean, some of these weddings pay $200-$400 a pop. And according to David Hidalgo, you know, $200-$400 and all the mole you can eat, that's a pretty good Saturday afternoon gig, right? And so Louis says in the book, if you got married in East LA between 74 and 80, we played your wedding, okay? And so they develop a name for themselves. They're playing local colleges. They're playing Cinco de Mayo shows up and down the coast, developing a name and a following. In 1975, PBS funded a program called La Futura, or no, I'm sorry, La Cultura. I got notes for this one because it's a lot of stuff to talk about, and I don't really want to forget anything and leave anything out. PBS 1975, they don't even have a record out yet, but they've got enough of a following that they're featured on this 30-minute documentary, and they're shown playing in and around, and you know, a couple of little interview snippets and that type of thing. And around this time, you can tell from watching the video that Frank Gonzalez really was kind of the de facto leader of the band. As a matter of fact, in one of the snippets, they're on the hillside behind Conrad Lozano's house, and they've got their instruments and their beers and their smokes, and one guy's holding the chicken, but they're playing music, and Frank's telling them what chord and what key, and you know, that note's flat, and da-da-da-da-da-da. So, I mean, and then basically in the La Cultura show, Frank does all of the emceeing, introduces the band members and the song titles and that type of thing. But not long after that, Frank started drinking heavily, started getting a little bit flaky himself and not showing up for gigs, not showing up for rehearsals. And before long, they voted him out of the band. So now they're down to a four-piece. And they're doing their thing. They get several gigs at local restaurants, doing kind of like the wandering mariachi thing, but not really that. They would play a set, but mostly traditional Mexican folk songs. But from time to time, as 4 o'clock turned into 6 o'clock and those afternoon drinkers started getting a little bit rowdy, they would yell out, "Hey, play The Doors, Roadhouse Blues, or play a Led Zeppelin song, or play a Grateful Dead song, or whatever." And these guys would do it. They would play those songs on the acoustic instruments that they had, but it wasn't long before one of them snuck in a guitar and an amp, and one of them snuck in an actual drum kit. And before long, they'd gone from being a traditional Mexican folk band to really a rock and roll covers band playing these songs as people would yell out, and it didn't go over so well with the restaurant management. They were let go, but it opened their eyes to realizing that they really could do both. And more importantly, they didn't have to do one or the other. They could do either, or they could do both and combine elements of both and that type of thing. Started to develop a really a great name for themselves as a roots rock band. Really leaning more at that time still towards the traditional Mexican music, though. The same time, there was a burgeoning punk scene going on the West Coast. And, you know, we're talking 1978, 1979. These guys had missed out on kind of the first wave of the English punk thing. And now punk's coming to America, and things are getting revved up and a little bit louder and a little bit speedier and, you know, a little bit punkier. And Los Lobos loved that. And they would be on the way to play one of these traditional Mexican folk music gigs, but they would be listening to things like the Blasters or the Plugs or Black Flag or, you know, the Germs or Fear or any one of these other bands that were starting to make kind of a name for themselves. As luck would have it, depending on how you look at the story, the new Johnny Lydon band, Public Image Limited, was coming to Los Angeles. Now, Johnny Lydon, otherwise known as Johnny Rotten, the lead singer of the Sex Pistols, they had skipped Los Angeles on their only American tour. They had gone to San Francisco, but they skipped LA. So this is their first time, these LA punks, to see the real deal up close and personal. And at the last minute, one of the bands, I think it was the 45s, decided to drop out of the show. And one of the management people called Los Lobos, called Louis Perez, and asked them if they wanted the gig. Louis said, "Sure." I can't imagine him not saying anything but "sure." "Do you want an opportunity to play?" is basically what he heard. Not, "Do you want an opportunity to play in front of a really angry, boisterous, loud punk crowd?" Maybe that would have changed his mind, maybe it wouldn't, but they went into this deal. They're wearing their Guayabera shirts, they've got their Mexican instruments. They come out to open for Public Image Limited and are immediately pelted with everything throwable. Nickels, dimes, quarters. Conrad Lozano says that up to a year later, he was still pulling quarters out of his guitar on. Now, They got spit on, they got yelled at, they got cursed, the whole nine yards. Because the show was a little bigger venue, a little bigger crowd, they had invited their friends and family and girlfriends and wives, and they're all at the backstage seeing what's going on to their husbands and boyfriends. They can't believe it. Everybody's crying, but Los Lobos, excuse me, they see an opportunity there. You know what? They stood their ground. They eventually skedaddled after about four or five songs when it just got to be too much. But in the meantime, they stood their ground. They had a certain portion of the crowd up and doing their thing, having fun. And they said, you know, there's an opportunity here. And maybe we can take advantage of it. And so they started really leaning into rockabilly and a slightly edgier sound. Along the way, David Hidalgo's brother-in-law's brother-in-law had purchased an accordion. It was always his desire when he retired, he was going to learn how to play accordion. And one night, David Hidalgo was over there. He picked it up, sounded pretty good on it. The brother-in-law's brother-in-law said, take that home with you and I'll get it back from you when I retire. He passed away before he retired. David Hidalgo learned how to play the accordion. There's very few instruments, whether it's pedal steel or the violin or the accordion or a guitar or whatever the case may be, there's very few instruments that you can't put in David Hidalgo's hands and him become a genius on it. And that's what he did with the accordion, which it gave him a driving, almost polka type sound, but also lots of Tex-Mex, Flaco Jimenez type thing. They could also do the norteño, the cumbias, the corridos, the mariachi. They could do it all. And then they could also, you've got Cesar over here writing these killer R&B and blues songs. So they could do really a little bit of all of this. And so before long, the inevitable happens. Slash Records, which was a subsidiary of Warner Brothers, had already signed the Blasters, a local band with a really, really nice following. And the Blasters and Los Lobos and the Blasters were big fans of each other. The Blasters really were helpful in handing out tapes and records and different things, saying, hey, you got to hear these guys, you got to hear these guys, you got to hear these guys. Before you know it, they've done that enough on their own label, Slash, that they signed them to a record deal. So that first record, Los Lobos del Este de Los Angeles, came out in 1978. It's all Mexican traditional folk songs. In 1980, they opened for Public Image Limited, signed with Slash Records, and by 1983, they've come out with their first EP. Now, along the way, they hook up with T-Bone Burnett, Steve Berlin comes along from the Blasters to help with production and engineering and that type of thing. But Steve Berlin is a huge fan of the Lobos because they play so many shows together. Steve sits in with the band quite often and eventually will become a part of that band. But right now, for this time, they're a four-piece. Louis playing drums, Conrad's playing bass, and Dave and Cesar are handling the guitar parts. And this EP, while it didn't sell a ton of copies, was very critically acclaimed. Now, this is T-Bone Burnett way before he was T-Bone Burnett. As a matter of fact, they were given a piece of notebook paper and said, hey, write down your top five or six producers, we'll see what we can do. T-Bone Burnett wasn't on any of their lists. At that time, he was best known as part of Bob Dylan's 75 touring band. He had recorded a couple of things that really had done nothing, but he had a great ear, and he really appreciated what the Los Lobos band was doing, and they ended up together. And this album has no traditional Mexican songs on it whatsoever. It's all rockabilly, Americana, just basic rock songs for the time. I mean, these songs could have coexisted with an R.E.M. record or that type of thing. But you've got Let's Say Goodnight, The Walking Song, and Selma, which won them their first Grammy. And then Come On, Let's Go, How Much Can I Do, What Do You Do, And it, you know, it's a wonderful, wonderful record. It's like a little time capsule. It's only 19 minutes long. Seems like you put it on and you're immediately flipping it, but it's a great little record, and it's a really good precursor of things that are to come. Okay, so this album gets a little bit of success. Before long, they go back into the studio again with T-Bone Burnett, and they come out with their first full-length, How Will the Wolf Survive? The songwriting here is leaps and bounds above where it was on A Time to Dance. On A Time to Dance is a fun little dance record. All of a sudden, they've kept the danciness, they've kept the groove. There's not a groove that Los Lobos can't wear out, okay? Hopefully you noticed that on the musical intro that we did. But now, you've got songs that are a little deeper, a little darker, danceable and hummable, but still telling a story about Mexican Americans and their plight and that type of thing. And you've got Don't Worry Baby, A Matter of Time, Corita Number One, Our Last Night, I Got Loaded, Will the Wolf Survive? This is a wonderful, wonderful record, and it tells the story of Ronald Reagan's America in a not too favorable light. Again, critically acclaimed. Again, didn't really sell that well. In 1985, Lenny Warnker, who is the A&R man for Warner Brothers Records, comes along, and he loves Los Lobos. Lenny Warnker, if you don't know, Lenny Warnker had been responsible with the A&R, so he was responsible with Joni Mitchell, Neil Young, Little Feat, just a host of other bands that maybe if they had been on any other label, wouldn't have been given the freedom they were to make the music that they love. But Lenny comes along and he says, hey guys, I've got a favor to ask. I'd like for you to do something with Paul Simon. Paul Simon had 5 multi-platinum albums with Simon and Garfunkel. His first few albums also sold very well. But then he signed with Warner Brothers. And all of a sudden, things didn't go so well. His first record for Warner Brothers was One Trick Pony, which was a little bit of a flop. It was a big flop. Next record up was Hearts and Bones. Although it's critically acclaimed now, it did nothing then. So Paul Simon needs a boost. He needs a shot in the arm. And so Lenny Warnker calls on Los Lobos. They go into the studio and really nothing's happening. Paul Simon really doesn't bring anything to the table, believe it or not. Dave Hidalgo's playing around with a little track called The Myth of Fingerprints. Paul likes it. He includes it on his Graceland record, which sells 500 million copies, and leaves the name Los Lobos off of the record. So that was a little bit of a drag. As a favor to Lenny, Steve Berlin also chooses to be a part of a new low-budget movie that nobody really expects to do a whole lot. It doesn't have a big-name actor in it, and like I said, it's a relatively low-budget for the time. But that movie turned out to be La Bamba, and that's what we know Los Lobos by for the most part. A lot of us that haven't dug a little bit deeper. So they work on this record, they record this record. Los Lobos, who has come out in the meantime with By the Light of the Moon, Shake, Shake, and Shakes, All I Wanted to Do Was Dance, Set Me Free, Rosalie, River of Fools, Tears of God, wonderful record. They're out on tour, they've done this. They thought, okay, that was fun, let's go tour our new record. They're out on tour with their new record. Next thing you know, they're getting phone calls. This is way before cell phones and internet and all of that. Hey, man, the record's at 150. Hey, man, the record's at 100. Hey man, the record's at 50, 20, 10. Hey man, the record is number one. Number one with a bullet. So now Los Lobos is getting a little bit of recognition. It's a little bit bittersweet though. They've been making music for 10 years. And they're finally getting some recognition for doing really a revved up cover song. That's not there. It was a written, not theirs. It was a Ritchie Valens tune. And so they love the success. How could you not? But they want to be known for their thing. So they've had a number one hit. It's time to go back into the studio. What do we do? Do we come out with another rock record? Because the first two records and the first EP didn't do so well. Do we come out with a Mexican folk record? Well, at this point in time, most of the people that knew Los Lobos for La Bamba had no idea that they started out as a traditional Mexican folk song band. And Louis Perez, who it said very rarely came up with, hey, let's do this idea, sits down and says, hey, this is what we need to do. We need to do an album of traditional Mexican folk songs. We need to pay homage to our roots. We need to shine a light on what other music we can play. And we need to come out with an acoustic Mexican record. And that's what they do. La Pistola y la Corazón. Gun to the heart, pistol to the heart. And that's exactly what it is. It's traditional folk, Mexican folk music. The lead vocals are handled for the most part by Cesar Rosas, which really was the only member of the band that actually spoke fluent Spanish. So he handles most of the lead. But again, another wonderful record, another really grown-up record. And this brought them their second Grammy, okay? If you don't have this, and it's not the easiest record to pick up, but if you don't have it, it's a wonderful listen. Stream it. You're going to fall in love with it, and then you'll go and buy it. So, as you can guess, a couple of hits and misses. La Bamba, number one with a bullet. Follow it up with a Mexican folk album. It didn't do so well, okay? And at this point, you know, you've got gigs and you've got critical acclaim, but you're not making a whole lot of money. And that had to be kind of a bummer for the guys. I'm so glad that they stuck with it and hung in there and continued to stay true to themselves and make the music that they love. Next up, 1990s, The Neighborhood. This album is their next foray into making a rock record. And it should have been a hit. It should have been huge. You've got Levon Helm is on it. John Hiatt is on it. At this point, the music had gotten a little bit too sophisticated for Louis to play drums on. So you've got Jim Keltner and a host of other wonderful drummers and percussionists. Songwriting, you know, and the album cover, I mean, I love this record, but it's just not the strongest record. Now, I love everything that we've talked about up to this point. I get those records. This record, the title track and Angel Dance really are the high points for me, and the rest of it's kind of meh, although it's Los Lobos, so I'll, of course, listen to it. So they take a break and decide what to do. Well, the guy that had been brought in, and I kind of skipped over this, they had laid down all of the songs for the La Bamba soundtrack, and then they took off on tour to promote By the Light of the Moon. While they were on tour, they got a call from Lenny saying, hey guys, we want you to come back and do a single. We want to do the La Bamba single. You can play it however you want to, have fun in the studio, tear it up, but we want you guys to come back and do the single. And they're like, okay. And so they go back and they hook up with, for the first time, the producer Mitchell Froom. Now, Mitchell Froom is a keyboardist. He's got a solo record out that hasn't done so well, but he's got some critical acclaim and some experience under his belt from having worked with a couple of successful acts, including Crowded House, the Australian band, Don't Dream It's Over. So he's got a little bit of clout. He comes into the studio, and he's one of those kind of guys, like T-Bone, that feels like, hey, let the band do what they do, okay? As a little side note, Chad Blake came in to engineer the record, and so that's the first time that Los Lobos and Mitchell Froom and Chad Blake got together, and obviously they produced La Bamba, so that's a wonderful thing. Well, they hook back up at the end of the neighborhood, and they're talking, and they're passing back and forth some musical ideas, and the next thing you know, the Lobos are back in the studio, and they come out with what most people think is their best record. I've heard people refer to it as their Sgt. Pepper's. It's not really that. There's nothing that is that psychedelic about it. But the songwriting is absolutely wonderful. And it's because Luis Perez and Dave Hidalgo and even Cesar Rosas were really on a roll, just really writing some fantastic music. And this album, top to bottom, is a perfect record. There's only a couple of songs that I might skip over, but you've got Dreamin' Blue, Wake Up Dolores, Angels with Dirty Faces, That Train Don't Stop Here, Kiko and the Lavender Moon, Saint Behind the Glass, Reva's House, When the Circus Comes, Arizona Skies, Short Side of Nothing, Two Janes, Wicked Rain, Whiskey Trail, Just a Man, Peace, and Rio de Tanampa. And if you were listening, that montage, that audio montage that I put together for the intro, it included, I think, three, maybe four songs off of this record. But this is an absolutely wonderful record. This is an original master recording, and it is absolutely one of my favorites, and it's critically acclaimed as well. So another critically acclaimed record that really just didn't sell a whole lot. You know, we're talking about people not really knowing what to do with Los Lobos. I didn't know anything about Los Lobos. I was walking through a CD warehouse one night, and I saw this little box, okay? And I thought, well, that looks pretty cool. And it was only like $8. And so I bought it. And I brought it home and I put it on. I wasn't really into it, to be honest with you. But there was one track, Kiko and the Lavender Moon, that I fell in love with. And before long, that song went on like every mixtape that I made for a couple of years. It's just a great song. But that's kind of, you know, Los Lobos has made all of this killer music, all of this critically acclaimed, wonderful music, and they're still not selling a ton of records. So, go and figure. They decide to switch gears again, just like they did after La Bamba and came out with La Pistola. They've come out with Kiko, experimental, trippy, rocky, bluesy, absolutely wonderful. Didn't go over. Let's switch gears again. And they come out with Papa's Dream. This is Los Lobos with Lelo Guerrero, who was a legend at that time. And this is for the diehard fans. It's fun, but it's really more of a kid's thing than anything else, okay? At that point, they came out with, right after that, in 96, they came out with Colossal Head. Now, Colossal Head is produced by Mitchell Froom and Chad Blake. It's got one of my favorite Los Lobos tracks, Mas y Mas, More and More. But this is yet again another album that failed to do a whole lot. And before long, Warner Brothers, who owns Slash Records, has dropped them from the label. So imagine that. You put out all this wonderful music, and now you're dropped from your label. So they regroup. They get together with Mammoth Records, who is owned by the Walt Disney Company. And they come out with this time. Now, I'll tell you what's maddening about being a Los Lobos fan. So Papa's Dream, this time, and the next few records that we're going to talk about were never even released on vinyl. colossal hit was released on vinyl. Try finding it these days. It's at least $100 a copy. It's just absolutely crazy. If there is a band out there that deserves a reissue program, it is Los Lobos. Please give us Colossal Head on vinyl. Please give us This Time on vinyl. This album comes out, it's a little bit more of a rock and roll affair. Obviously, by this time, we're up to 1999. Boy bands are gone. Heavier music is in. These guys rise to the occasion and put out one of the most rocking records of their career. Viking hits hard, man. Cumbia Raza. But even the pretty songs like This Time and High Places, La Playa, just absolutely great songs. Wonderful eclecticism and experimentation. Absolutely fantastic. And again, didn't sell a whole lot. And it's a shame. Oh, man, it's just a shame. Check it out. After the ride, they regroup. They come out with The Town and the City. This is another one. I can't find it on vinyl, but it's a wonderful record. It's got The Valley. It's got Little Things, No Puedo Más, Free Up, If You Were Only Here Tonight. It's a wonderful little record, and it's Los Lobos doing what they do so well, and it sounds so good, and it's recorded so well, and again, it didn't really sell that well. Next thing up, you've got Los Lobos Goes Disney, which is them doing a bunch of Disney covers, which was a fantastic record. We could do another show just on that. After that, you've got one of my favorite album covers, if not one of my favorite Lobos records. This is Tin Can Trust. I'm so glad this is available on vinyl. I love that record. And while it's not one of my favorites, doesn't mean that I don't love it. Burn It Down, On Main Street, Yo Canto, Tin Can Trust, Jupiter or the Moon is another one of those Kiko and the Lavender Moon type of songs that's just really cool and groovy and funky, and I absolutely love it. Great record. Next up was Gates of Gold. Gates of Gold came out in 2015. And this is a really well-recorded record that, again, it doesn't have a hit. And really, none of these records had a radio hit. But it's another really solid record. This leans, while This Time was a little bit rockier, Gates of Gold is a little prettier, but it's a beautiful record. It's very deep, it's recorded really well, and it sounds really well, but again, it's another record that just didn't do as much as it probably should have. Next up, they came out with, what did I skip? I skipped Good Morning, Aslan. This is another one of those. This is a great record as well. The CD is enhanced, comes with a little video CD of the making of the record. This is one that if you can find it on vinyl, good luck paying for it. I don't know why. It's just the way that it is. But again, another critically acclaimed record that just didn't do that well. Fast forward, sorry for that little mix up there, guys, to 2019 with their Christmas record. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time talking about this. It is a Christmas record. It is one of my favorite Christmas records, though, right there with Calexico's Christmas record and the Peanuts Christmas record and a couple of other ones. But they play mostly Spanish songs, Mexican songs, and they're absolutely beautiful. And it's something a little bit different, something you can throw on and people will be kind of like, oh, well, what's that? And then 2021, you've got Native Sons, and this won them their last Grammy. And this is a wonderful record. This is an homage to their LA roots. And they cover everybody from Little Willie G to The Midnighters to Buffalo Springfield on this record. They do a wonderful version of Bluebird. I always get a little bit nervous when I see that someone's done a cover of Bluebird, because that's one of my favorite songs. However, James Gang did it really well, and what do you know? So do Los Lobos, okay? So that was the last new music that we were given by Los Lobos. However, hopefully it was a needed shot in the arm for them. The album did really well and won them another Grammy. And so hopefully that'll fuel the fire and we'll get more and more and more new music from Los Lobos. They're coming up on 50 years as a band. They've been making music for a long time. I would imagine these guys love to record and love to tour, but probably love being at home with their families at this point in their lives, with their grandkids and their great-grandkids and that type of thing. So hopefully we'll continue to get more new Los Lobos music. I want to, real quick, I've got so much stuff scattered here in front of me, I forgot several other things. Let's talk about The Ride for a moment. The Ride came out in 2004. It has Mavis Staples, it's got Elvis Costello, it's got John Hyatt, it's got Tom Waits, it's got one of my favorite rock en Espanol bands, Café Tacuba. This is a really wonderful, weird, funky, well-rounded record that should have done better. It wasn't even released on vinyl. Give us this on vinyl, please. Give us this on vinyl. It's another wonderful little record. And there was a little EP that accompanied this a few months later, where they went in and did a few other deeper little covers. So that's it for Los Lobos. I know that you're probably thinking, thank God, Mark, that was enough. But I do have some honorable mentions. I can't do a video without an honorable mention, certainly not a video on one of my favorite bands. I talked a moment ago about this little box, and this is, you know, just another band from East LA, okay? And it's a wonderful little comp, but perhaps out of all of my box sets, this one. So this is El Cancionero Más y Más, which is the songbook, More and More. This is a 4-CD comp. The design for the packaging isn't that great, but it is beautiful. It's got some really nice, and you know, Luis Perez is a wonderful artist, and it's got some wonderful art, some wonderful photographs. It's a great record. As a matter of fact, or great little document. As a matter of fact, I wanted to show you guys this. This is one of my favorite photos of the band, just hanging out in the kitchen, okay? Eating and talking and discussing music and family and all kinds of different stuff. We talked about the book, Dreamin' Blue. We mentioned briefly earlier about their soundtrack work. One of my favorites would have to be Desperado. This is a wonderful, wonderful record, and their instrumentals here are fantastic. Robert Rodriguez, you know, they had planned on coming out with an album around the time they finished up work on this, and they had nothing left because Robert Rodriguez is one of those directors that wants every moment of film to have music to go along with it, and he pretty much bled them dry. But it's a wonderful record, and of course it's got some other bands on it too, but that's worth checking out. There's the Kiko live record. Kiko was successful enough that they came out with a live rendition of it, start to finish, which is also accompanied by a DVD. In 93, right after Kiko, Louie and Dave had enough ideas left over. The wheels kept turning, the ideas kept coming, the creative juices kept flowing. They rented a little office, and would meet daily and come up with different song ideas. Some of them fit the Los Lobos mode, some of them really didn't. They got together again with Mitchell Froom and Chad Blake, and they formed the Latin Playboys. I can't talk about this record enough. I love Los Lobos. This record is kind of like Los Lobos meets Captain Beefheart / CCR / Brian Eno. I mean, it's just weird. It's eclectic. It's great. Sounds come out of everywhere, nowhere, and everywhere. And it's just wonderfully funky and absolutely beautiful. And I love it. It came out as a CD-only release in 93, finally on Record Store Day, I think 2017 maybe, they came out with this copy. It's fantastic, absolutely. It is absolutely criminal that their other record, Dose, which came out in 99, still has not been released on vinyl. It's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. This is fantastic music. Fiesta, Erotica, Cuckoo's Blues, Ironsides, Mustard, Nubian Priestess, Dose, Latin Trip, Tormenta Boulevard, Lemon and Ice, Loco Man, Toro, Pelotero, and Paula and Fred. Paula and Fred was included on the Red Hot and Red Hot and Blue comp, Muerte, Tito Muerte, Muerte Silencia, something like that, with Money Mark, and it's funky, and it's just, it's like Beastie Boys meets Los Lobos, and it's absolutely wonderful. So if you don't know Latin Playboys, check them out. Real quick, and just as high on my list is the one and only record from Hound Dog, never released on vinyl. We need a Record Store Day release of this record as well. This is Dave Hidalgo with Canned Heat's last singer, and I'm sorry, I can't remember his name right now. They say that when Lucinda Williams first heard this record, she was like, man, is that dude sick? He's just got such a groaning, such a kind of a weird left-of-center vocal delivery that it's just weird enough that Tom Waits put it on one of his top 10 records of all time. But the guitar playing, the violin that David plays, violin, fiddle, however you want to refer to it, weird, funky, crazy, eclectic, absolutely wonderful. Pick that up. You can get the CD pretty cheap. And then, you know, Dave Hidalgo with, I think, Vince Gill, Jerry Douglas, and David Hidalgo have played on more records than any other three people combined in any genre. He's just simply played for everybody. He's got so many different side projects. We can't talk about them all, but I am going to talk about Lost Super 7. And this is a wonderful record. Absolutely wonderful. There is a video on YouTube, live in the studio, of them recording the track Teresa that will blow your mind. It's so good. And then last but not least, this is Three Skulls and the Truth. This is a little bit more straight ahead, rock and roll. You've got David Hidalgo, Mento Ninji, and Luther Dickinson of the North Mississippi All-Stars. Bluesy, funky, Derek Trucks, Jimi Hendrix, Roy Gallagher type of thing, but absolutely wonderful. These cats can play, and this is a great record. So there you go. I have no idea how long this video has been. Hopefully it hasn't been horribly long, but I've really had a good time talking about Los Lobos. I wish you guys were here so that we could turn the camera off and just put one of these records on and crank it, cook a little food and have a cocktail or two and just hang out and listen to some great music. But that is Los Lobos. And if you don't know Los Lobos, or if Los Lobos to you are kind of like one of those Yeah Right bands or the La Bamba band or whatever the case may be, I'm telling you, you owe it to yourself to check them out. They are wonderful. And hopefully sometime in the near future, we'll get either new music from them or some of these CDs will be reissued on vinyl. That would be absolutely wonderful. But in the meantime, Los Lobos, más y más. Everybody have a wonderful weekend. Take it easy. I can't wait to see you next time. Take care. Bye.